Good evening. I hope everyone is enjoying the local foods this evening and you're ready for the presentation portion of our lovely evening together. This evening, I hope you noticed, for those of you who have been our guests before, thanks to the efforts of Tom Wong, we have a lovely new projection and sound system. And so we'll have a lovely presentation and a nice big screen. As our guests tonight, we're fortunate enough to have two speakers with us this evening to talk about sustainability, cultivating resilience, and just being good stewards. Joining us tonight is Dayna Reggero. Dayna is an award-winning storyteller and connector. She's the producer and director of the Climate Listening Project, which is a collaborative film project connecting conversations on climate and community around the world. This past year, she was honored for her work as a top outstanding conservationist at the Roosevelt Ash Awards and featured by Mountain True at the Wild and Scenic Film Festival. Joining her is Laura Legnick. Laura is an award-winning soil scientist and has been exploring agricultural sustainability for more than 30 years as a researcher, policymaker, educator, and farmer. Her work in sustainable farming systems was nationally recognized with the USDA Secretary's Honor Award, and she contributed to the third National Climate Assessment. Laura led an academic program in sustainable agriculture at Warren Wilson College for more than a decade, where she also served as the Director of Sustainability Education. Her new book, Resilient Agriculture, Cultivating Food Systems for a Changing Climate, has looked at climate change, resilience, and the future of food through 25 award-winning sustainable producers, interviewing them for their stories across the U.S. So please join me in welcoming Laura and Dayna.
Thank you so much. What an amazing meal, what an amazing university community. We've just been welcomed. So lovely. This has just been beautiful. Thank you all so much. Tonight, we will explore the crucial role of stories as a means for positive change, particularly the power of story to support the shared learning needed to spark community-based resilience. We have worked to document stories about food, faith, and how they're connected in across the North Carolina, across the United States, and around the world. And I'm excited to be working with Laura Legnick and to be here today together as part of our Cultivating Resilience Tour. So thank you, and here's Laura.
Good evening. It's a little bit interesting situation up here, so we're gonna be kind of figuring that out. Well, by the end of our talk, we'll have good balance going on. So as Dayna said, we've been working together, going on almost 2 years, to gather stories, to hear what kinds of stories people around the country have about changes in weather, about what they think about it, and how those changes are affecting their own community. And as you can see, I wonder, can we get any more brightness either on those up here in the, or out darker in the room? Because you really can't see. Yeah, that's okay. And then we need to, if we could, maybe a little more focus would be great too. That's one thing we did not check this morning. I'm thinking it's okay. Let's get this right, and then we'll move. And then we'll move on. Can you change focus at all? Or do you have to be up there? Okay. Well, we are all going to go with this. So one thing that I know from the work that I've done around all kinds of farming issues and food issues, not just climate change, is that everybody has their own story, and there are lots of different stories. And we're not here tonight to try to change your own story about climate change, about changes in weather. What we're here to do is share stories, and we hope hear from you about some stories. about weather, about food, about faith, about community, about where we want to go together in the future, and what works for us in terms of working together to create a better future. We need to go back one up. So, lots of different stories. Here are just a few of the different stories that are out there already about climate change. And if we did a good job picking them, then you probably can find yourself somewhere in one of these stories here. The stories are really at odds, and they create a lot of conflict and divide in our communities. And one of the things that Dayna and I are working hard on is figuring out how we can reach across that divide by sharing our stories and some kind of common ground to move forward. And we started this work before this election cycle, but everything that's happened in the last year has just tells us how important this work is to reach across divides, to find common ground, to begin to move forward. I think we've made a lot of work in our country to do that in the coming year. So lots of stories. I want to tell you the story that science tells about climate change and food. Just a little bit of science here, and then we'll move into farmer stories. So one of the things that science says is that food contributes about 25% of all the global greenhouse gas emissions. And remember, greenhouse gases are those gases that science says stores heat in the atmosphere and is raising our global temperature. So you can see that food system emissions are taking about 25%, and that if you look at that smaller circle, then you can see that the blue part of that pie is the production part of food. The green part is about land and how we use it and how that changes emissions. And then the orange part is energy and other kinds of emissions that are related to the rest of the food system. And one of the things that is often surprising to people is how much the production part, the part that we put a lot of effort and focus on in agriculture, is really only half the story of the emissions created in agriculture. And this is now looking specifically at a food system. It's not the US food system, it's the UK food system. We don't have any data like this for the US food system, but it would be interesting, I think, if we did. Food system pretty similar to ours in lots of respects, so I think it makes a good proxy for what kinds of emissions are going on in our own food system. And again, one of the surprising things, take a look at that pie and how it's split up. This is in terms of greenhouse gas emissions. Again, what you see is agriculture is really not the big story here. It's part of the story for sure, the production part. But look at transport, look at processing, look at retailing. Those three together are larger than the production part of agriculture. And then notice that green part of the slice of pie. You might not be able to read that, but that's waste. That's food waste. That's the waste of edible food. About 30% of all the edible food produced in this country is thrown away. And not because it's gone bad. We just don't eat it. So those are the ways, the different ways beyond agriculture that science says we're creating these greenhouse gases which are warming the planet. So the other story, just I wanted to give you a little picture of how this warming is happening according to scientists. So this is kind of a complicated slide, but really all I want you to see is that the x-axis is 1880 to 2000, kind of the last 100 years. I'm a lumper, by the way, not a splitter. So I'm gonna look at something like that and say, that's about 100 years. My husband, he'd be saying, no, wait a minute, it's 120 years. Okay, he's a splitter, I'm a lumper. So if you notice me doing that, that's just me. If you have a question, we can talk about it later. So this is kind of a picture of the climate system, the global climate system. And there are things in the climate system that tend to cool the planet. That's what the y-axis is telling you. And things that tend to warm up the planet. And so that red line there, those are all the greenhouse gases. And if you notice, that's really the only driver that has consistently moved in one direction. Okay. So I want to finish up this little climate science workshop here with just a few pictures of the history of weather history now in the US. And all of these images come from the third National Climate Assessment. It's a beautiful website. And the link is right down at the bottom there if you want to go take a look at these and many other images that talk about both weather history in the US and also projections of the future. So this is temperature change. Roughly, the map in the middle is roughly the last century, first half compared to the last half, the last century. And then those bar graphs, which are a little tough to see, are just decadal changes, how temperature has changed in different regions around the country. So the country overall has increased in average temperature, except for one part of the world, and we live in it. I think that's pretty interesting, but I don't have the time tonight to get diverted into discussions about how our experience of climate change, weather changes, is very personal and local, or community-based and local. It really depends on where you live, how you're experiencing changes in climate. Okay. And this is the same setup of data, but this is for precipitation. So precipitation is changing. It's getting drier in the southwest. It's getting a lot wetter in the northern tier states, particularly in New England. But really, these two maps are average annual temperatures, average annual rainfall. I didn't have time tonight to get into the details, but what's really affecting people right now all over the world, it's not so much these average changes, it's the changes in extremes. Much more frequent and heavier rainfalls, for example, which this data doesn't really show. And for temperature, more frequent extremes of temperature, warm spells or hot spells in the winter, and more variable spring and fall weather. And this is just a little that I'll share about the future. These are projections now. Everything I've shown you up to now has been history. It happened. This is also from the Third National Climate Assessment, and these are some of the challenges that have been projected for the Southeast region, the region that we live in. Sea level rise, we have more than any other region on the coast. We have more coastline than any other region. And so sea level rise is really going to play a large role in the next 50 years, 200 years of the people in the Southeast. We'll see more increasing temperatures, more frequent, intense, extreme heat, increasing heavy rainfalls, and more frequent drought. And then this new story for us in the Southeast is going to be competition for water. That's already starting to happen. We had an experience of that earlier, the first part of this century in our region. Competition for water across state lines. If you remember, Atlanta was pretty close to going dry. And that's going to become much more of a challenging feature living here in the Southeast. And so that's just the science story. And I don't say that facetiously. Science is one way that we can look at the world, that we can learn about the world, and that we can tell stories using data about the meaning of what we see in the world. But there are many other ways that are equally important for helping us move forward, that we can know the world, lots of different ways of knowing. And storytelling really helps us make sense of what we're experiencing. And so I'm gonna pass it back to Dayna and let her talk to you a little bit about storytelling.
So talking and conversations is how we find solutions. Basically, all of you have shared stories and all of you have listened to stories. Myths, stories that are handed down through generations, and in the day-to-day, the conversations that we have are how we find solutions and how we create resilience locally and now with the internet. It's how we connect all around the world. So I created the Climate Listening Project 2 years ago, and I've been trying to connect hopeful stories on climate and community. And by listening to stories that are specifically about what we care about and what we need, I'm able to connect with different groups and then connect these different groups, creating collaborations and conversations that may not have happened before. With Laura, we've been together traveling on the Cultivating Resilience Tour since as long as I've been doing the Climate Listening Project. I have a bachelor's in communications and a master's in applied science. And so for 15 years, back in the beginning, it was through television, print media, and now through videos and blogs and social media, I'm able to connect these stories. So Laura had a listening project. Her book, Resilient Agriculture, interviewed 25 farmers around the country that had all been farming more than 30 years and had seen the impacts of climate change and also were creating solutions, things that other farmers might be able to recognize, challenges, risks that they might also take, or ways that were being created for, solutions that were being created for resilience. And so going out on the road and having an opportunity with Laura to not only listen to their stories, but to film them and then share these stories with the world. The reason we selected the farmers that we selected was so that it would be a comfortable space, not only for the folks that were sharing their stories, but the people that were listening to them. So it's very much targeted audiences, specific choices that were made on who was interviewed, so that it would be farmer to farmer, faith leader to faith leader. And so we'd like to, I think, talk about resilience.
So the last bit that I want to introduce, so I introduced some storytelling that science gives us about climate change and changes in weather. And I want to just speak very briefly about resilience. And the main reason is that there's this public notion, the kind of the meaning typically we give to this resilience is about bouncing back. So nod your head if that's kind of what resilience means. I just want to get a sense. Or don't nod your head, that's okay. I saw a few. But in general, when I speak to audiences, that's what we generally know that word to mean. And it turns out that resilience is a fairly well-developed science. And it's at least 50 years old, if not older. And it has been developed in parallel in several different scientific disciplines, in ecology, in psychology, in parallel and separately, with not a whole lot of crossover. Ecology, psychology, engineering, and then the basis of the engineering is physics, and then hazards and risk management. And each of these different disciplines has defined the word a little bit differently. And the definition that is in general use is the physics or engineering definition, and that's that idea to bounce back. But it turns out that the resilience science developed by ecologists and psychologists are more useful when we're thinking about food systems. And the definition of resilience in ecology by ecologists is really different from the engineering definition. Resilient systems have three different capacities, and all of them are important to maintaining or sustaining a system through disturbance and change. And the first capacity is this idea of response capacity. And the cool idea there, to me, particularly when we're thinking about damaging effects of something like changing weather, is that you can actually manage systems so that they can respond so that there is no damage, to avoid damage from disturbances. And then the second capacity is recovery capacity, and that's that balance, the bouncing back. Excuse me, I just ate a wonderful meal. And it's that bouncing back idea that when we do experience a disturbance that causes damage, we can bounce back pretty quickly. And then the third capacity in the ecological notion of resilience is the one that gives me the most hope and is most exciting to me as I think about these big issues, challenges facing us in this century. And that's this transformation capacity. And that basically means that we have the capacity to change when we see that the system that we have now isn't working well for us, or won't work well for us in coming years. That we can step back as a community and say, we need to change this. We can change it to something better. And that's this idea of bouncing forward. So one interesting thing about the way these capacities work together is that if we do sustain damage, so we're in that maybe recovery capacity mode of resilience, what about if we think about bouncing forward into something better? So when we rebuild after damage, which I know this area, I live in Asheville, I've watched all the flooding that has happened as a result of the last hurricane. So that when we experience damage, rather than bouncing back to what we had, how about we bounce forward to something better? So that's the basic notion of this ecological and psychological resilience. And the theories, the concepts, the frameworks that you can find around resilience in those two disciplines are actually very useful as we think about how we're going to manage the food system in more variable weather. So this is the last little bit, and then we'll get into the videos. I know you want to meet the farmers and all the other folks that Dayna has spoken to over the last couple of years. So go ahead and one more in advance. So I'd like to show this slide just so that you get a sense that resilient science is actually pretty well developed. And in particular, there's been recent, in the last 4 or 5 years, real development in an application of resilient science to food systems. And this is one example. This is a set of design criteria for resilient food systems. And I'm not going to go into all of them, but just know that they're there and that we can use this both to assess the resilience, to evaluate the resilience of a food system or a food system. And we can also use this to guide the redesign of farms and food systems. So there's a lot of good information in resilient science. And then I just want to point out to you some of the social, well, the other thing is notice ecological as well as social design criteria. So resilience that's developed in ecology is really starting to merge with psychology. We're thinking about human social ecological systems, the interaction of humans with nature. And food, I think, is probably the most compelling example of how we interact with and depend on nature. So it's a great place to start thinking about this together as a community. And just notice that one of those social criteria is reflective and shared learning. And the way you do that is tell each other stories. So as Dayna said, my step into listening projects was case study research with farmers across the U.S. I reported on this research in a book that was published last summer called Resilient Agriculture, called Cultivating Food Systems for a Changing Climate. And this group of farmers, they were award-winning sustainable farmers around the country. I chose sustainable farmers because they are not eligible for federally subsidized crop insurance. So I thought that as a group, they would make a great study of how do you manage a farm for climate resilience, because they're not eligible for any weather insurance. So they had to figure out how to do it another way. So as a group of 25, they've all been farming at least 30 years, many of them over 40, and many of them second, third, fourth, sometimes fifth generation on the same farm. So they had weather stories from their family, and they also had quite a bit of experience of their own in the locations where they were farming of weather. They were growing fruits, vegetables, grains, livestock products, dairy. In there. Basically, they were growing food all around the country, and they were growing at scale or larger than the average farm in the area growing those same products. I asked them questions about what kinds of changes in weather. Actually, I started out by asking questions, could you tell me about climate change on your farm? And I got nothing. And occasionally the farmer would say, well, I can't tell you about climate change, that's a scientific thing. Or sometimes they said, that's just a liberal hoax, right? But for whatever reason, they basically couldn't talk to me about climate change. And then I said, well, how about weather? Has weather changed? And man, I could not shut them up. So, you know, I learned very firsthand that weather is our lived experience. Weather is what we experience, not climate change. And they told me a lot about changes in weather, about how they're adapting to them. And probably the most interesting question I asked in the survey was, how do you manage your assets to build climate resilience? And they had a lot to say about that as well. So they recognized that there were different assets on the farm. Soil quality, biodiversity, and diversified high-quality markets were three clear tools or assets that these farmers use to reduce climate risk on their farm.
Interrelated and interdependent, and yet independent at the same time. One thing, just to interject, you hear a little noise in the background, that's my grandkids. And part of why I'm doing this farm is it's for their benefit. It's for the future generations. And I think if we don't farm and eat with the future generations in mind, we're making a mistake. I tell my friends and politicians and whoever asks, we don't grow a single commodity on this farm. I just hate the term commodity and the mentality of commoditizing food. We grow only food on our farm. We grow food for families to nurture their children and to maintain their own health. So that's our goal, and that's what we try to do. Quint Farm Ranch has really evolved over the years in very significant ways. First of all, the most significant thing that we did in about 1985 is trade my cattle herd for a flour mill. And it was diversification, but quite a different type of diversification. I then changed from, just a couple years later, from chemical farming to organic farming. Planted our first organic crop in 1986, and so that was a big change when we converted the whole farm to organic. Then I spent probably 25 years trying to figure out the best ways of maximizing organic production systems so that they would be sustainable and reproducible. When you talk about soil quality in relation to drought or weather change, it's a very important question. And of course, the main thing with soil quality is having the soil in the first place. So our first goal is not to have it either blow away or wash away. And since we've converted to organic, I've seen much less erosion in wind and in water. The soil is more absorbent, so it soaks up the rains quicker. So I'm having less water erosion. Both of those things have been very important to us. As climate change becomes more pronounced, I think we're going to have to continue to use changes in our farming to survive. We just don't want to survive. We want to actually be successful. That's how you pass it on to the next generation. We want to leave the land better than we found it. We want to leave them with hope for success and the opportunity to farm as they like and the way they would like to do it.
So Bob farms 5,000 acres in the Golden Triangle of Montana, which is where the majority, 99, virtually all, of the wheats that we use in pasta is grown in the U.S. We chose this. We have another video later on of Southeast farmers, but we chose Bob's video to start with tonight because we're thinking about food and faith and community. And Bob was so sweet. He basically said, we were there all day fun filming, and he basically said around lunchtime, okay, let's stop, I'm gonna make you lunch, let's go get it. And so you really saw what happened that day. We went out to his fields and got some veggies, we went into his garden, and then he cooked it for us, and he got us all involved in cooking this meal, and we sat down and shared this meal together that came from his land. And this is really a beautiful expression of this idea of the commensal community. And talk to your biology professors or your ecology professors to find out a little more about commensal, this idea. But basically it means eating without harm, relating to each other without harm. And so really I think that part of resilient agriculture and food system is figuring out how we can be more mutually beneficial both to the species under our care in agriculture. Obviously, there's going to be harm involved when you eat, but we can try to reduce that harm. We can try to maximize the benefits between different, not only different species, but different communities and different parts of the food system. So we want to try to create this commensal table. And there are three different aspects of the food system that we can use to start thinking about how do we create this commensal table. And the first one is that we think about moral economy, that we really start thinking about not just a money economy, but we start thinking about how do we share and how do we create flows and communities that are actually beneficial for everyone. It's not a crazy idea, and there's a lot of good information out there about how we can do that kind of shared economy. And the second is proximity. So it turns out that in order for humans to care, we actually need to be in close proximity. And if we can see what our actions do, then we are more likely to behave towards others with respect and care and love. So we need to be in proximity or in community with each other. And the final one is nature as measure. And that's just basically the idea that, you know, this planet has been around a long time and it has figured out how to get things done. And we can use nature as a model to get things done better in human communities as well. There's also this sense of the table as a very important place to share faith. And so we can think about the moral economy and the connections there to spiritual life. And this idea of nature as measure and how we can care for God's creation. So all of these ideas get wrapped up around this table.
You learn a lot about how physical systems and numbers hook together. Then you go home into your faith life and you understand, well, this is so much more than that. It's about how people hook together and fit together and how can communities of faith and communities of fellowship and communities of conscience do a better job of connecting us while we deal with the changing climate.
As we went further and further into it, we discovered that there was no need to isolate or have one denomination or one religion working on this because every mainstream religion has a mandate to care for creation.
I'm so grateful for Pope Francis and for the ways that he's connecting the dots between nature and creation and social justice, where he is recognizing that this is not just an issue about planting trees or caring for our water, it's about caring for people, in particular, the people that are most impacted by climate change.
It is up to us as people of faith to love the people in poverty and to love this planet. We love and care for ourselves to ensure that this planet will survive and thrive to serve and give life to all of us.
My commitment to having as little of an impact on the planet as I can have and to inspiring others to not just care in their hearts but to care with their behaviors is a huge part of my personal commitment to not only my planet, but to my faith.
The church taking such strong steps, such leadership steps, to tell everybody that we need to act as stewards of the environment just fills me with pride and just reinforces my belief that we can overcome these problems together.
We are recognizing the moral obligation we have to be a good steward and to show our gratitude to God by not being wasteful and by taking care of the many blessings and gifts that God has given us.
I am a Catholic and a public school science educator, and I support our Pope's encyclical.
Finally, the Pope is doing something that all of us can approve of.
Having such a big figure come out to talk about how we should change our habits for the climate is a great thing.
You know, our Catholic Church is huge, and it's worldwide. What if every diocese, parish, school, would pick one project and do it to support the Pope's encyclical? What do you think that would do for our kids and grandkids?
We're asking congregations to serve as an example to the community by putting in energy-efficient appliances, practicing conservation, preaching and teaching about climate change, and encouraging and inspiring people to be better stewards of creation.
It makes me proud both that my parish and that my Pope has exercised a great deal of leadership, not only the issue of climate change and how it exists, but how it affects people and how we need to deal with its impacts.
This really is an issue about ethics and morality and how we treat each other and how we treat this gift of life and this gift of a planet. And those are moral questions, those are spiritual questions. They're not just political ones or scientific ones. We have to come together and figure out how to address this problem, and I believe that we can do it, but we need all of you.
So, faith, communities, people, these themes have come up over and over and over again in our work. And one way that we can think about coming together, as was described in that last video, we can think about being on one work. This is our one world. This is our common home. And the Laudato Si last summer, was huge. It was huge in our work. And although that was a Catholic faith community that brought that document forth, what we saw was that faith communities of all kinds came around that idea and the powerful statement that was made in the Laudato Si. I spent last year working with the food and religious leadership program at Wake Forest, going around all over the state in panel discussions. And those, it was an interesting position for me to be put with a bunch of religious scholars. And I served as the scientist on this panel. Programs, meeting room only. The Laudato Si brought forth, I think, some kind of a feeling that we're all feeling, that something is not right, that we need to change the way that we're relating to each other and to the earth. And it's a beautiful, in my view, the Laudato Si, beautiful expression of 100 years or more, really, certainly the last 50 at least, of our concerns about what industrialism has done to this planet and where we're likely to be headed and how we can change direction, change course. And certainly climate change, based on the scientific story, is a major product of industrialism. So we want to finish off here with a video from the Southeast. So you're going to see three Southeast sustainable farmers that are all featured in resilient agriculture.
Resilience requires us to seek new eyes, to ask different kinds of questions, to embrace uncertainty, and to find opportunity in change.
Not that long ago, maybe 10, 15 years ago, climate change was not a household word. Today, when you turn on the news, you hear it. So, what are the discussions on becoming climate change discussions?
We've had last year over 100 degree temperatures several days in a row. Not used to 100 degrees, maybe 1 or 2 days, but then back to it was like 4 or 5 days. So the temperature has been a lot hotter. The heat is not good. You know, I mean, it'll take a toll on the cattle.
Weather extremes are becoming more and more pronounced, more and more prominent. 2002 was the driest year in 100 years in Central North Carolina. 2003 was the wettest year in 100 years. 2007 was the driest year ever recorded here. 2010 was the hottest summer ever recorded. 2010, 11, and 12, July was the hottest July ever recorded here.
2% of us farmers, 100% of us are eaters. We're all impacted by climate change.
Farmers and ranchers have something unique to teach us about climate resilience.
Trail blazing is so much easier than trying to live with what we lived with in the past, where we sold our milk for less than it cost us to make it. I'm not a rice grazer. I'm I'm a forager of crops. That's what makes them so happy, is that they're having this beautiful, lush, quality forage 12 months out of the year. And you can wait till the situation is already there. You got a drought, okay, so what can you plant or what can you not plant?
When I operated this farm as a centralized, commoditized, industrialized farm, I never thought of it as a strip mine. It was an element of that kind of operation. But now that we operate as a living, regenerative organism, the resilience of it comes from that.
We have always managed for varying weather because we get all kinds of weather here in the Southeast. And so we try to put our eggs in a lot of different baskets. We spread our risks to weather and everything else out by doing a wide variety of crops over a wide period of the season. We are growing more crops undercover in greenhouses because that gives us a buffer against the weather. But in general, we have always managed for variable weather, and that serves us well as we get ever more variable weather.
We know enough to take the first steps along the path to our resilient future. Let's begin.
48 feet to the low tin patch rise, to the bottle, to the consumer, and it's all right here. And I have other people that are doing this now. They're grazing. I have farmers that are doing bottling and the whole world, just everything that I am.
I don't have any doubt that people will continue to adapt and grow and learn in the face of whatever radical changes come along. But I don't think it's going to be easy.
I know the decision worldwide, not in the hands of us all, the decision worldwide in the hands of the consumer. It makes demands on how they want their food grown.
As I have said to many people who have limited knowledge of what it is that we do here, no matter what the weather's doing, it's usually benefiting something and it's detrimental to something else. There are the wide variety of things that we grow over the wide range of the season. It's really, it's our crop insurance, and it's what makes us successful.
The future here is very exciting to me. When I first started making the changes from commoditized, industrialized, centralized agriculture to this organism that we call life and pastures, I thought it was a destination. I now see it as a journey.
This is the Climate Listening Project.
Okay, so those were just a few of the Climate Listening Project videos, and they were very targeted videos, like I mentioned in the beginning. And so if you didn't see yourself in one of those videos, there's a good chance that if you go to climatelisteningproject.org, there's somebody there that is sharing your story or is similar or is somebody that you might be able to look to say, hey, that person's just like me. Faith that connects you, whether it's your love of forests, maybe fishing, hunting, or just bird watching. Food, family, community. When you ask people what they care about in the polls, they say health, they say clean air, clean water, my children, food, access to food, faith. But all of those things are connected to climate change. So I encourage all of you to have local climate change conversations, to continue these conversations, and thank you.
Any questions?
Any stories?
This is very brief. I am a pastor of a church. I do know that the Interfaith Power and Light people have energy auditors that will come to churches and will do an audit for different churches and different institutions in their buildings. I know that there's a fellow in Raleigh that will you want somebody coming to this, you can do a better job of energy production and use in your church, try them.
Yes.
Thank you.
That's absolutely true. And Interfaith Power and Light is a wonderful national group that is wanting to do energy audits, get solar panels on as many different faith institutions as possible. So out in Western North Carolina, we have a group called the Creation Care Alliance. And each faith even now has groups that are working on, you know, starting local greening chapters at your church or at your synagogue or at your mosque. Each place now is looking at climate change in a new way. And even businesses and universities, folks, government now have to have climate adaptation plans. People are thinking about it in new ways. So there's a lot of resources out there, and I definitely encourage you all, in whatever your sector is, architecture, real estate, health, there's resources out there for you.
And if you're a grandparent or a teacher or a kid, there's resources out there too. And my own sense of it after that experience last year of serving on those Laudato Si panels is that I really gained a new appreciation for